Over the millennia, we have seen many great nations rise and fall within the Warhammer world. Many powerful kingdoms of dwarves and elves have stood the test of time, spawning many great warriors, towering cities, and inspiring leaders. The humans, while considered more primitive by these more advanced races, are no exception to their advancement of the world. Despite the many terrors of this world, the humans have persisted, even building great nations that still stand to this day. Perhaps the greatest human nation to ever rise in the Warhammer world is the Empire of Man, simply known as the Empire. For more than 2,000 years, this great nation, which is manned by many separate cultures of men, has survived all the great horrors thrown at them. Even the great Nagash himself was not able to destroy the Empire in its early years of founding. Still, they persist with steel and faith, ever defending their lands from any who wish them harm. Much of the early history of the Empire is unknown, with many scholars and historians attempting to fill the gaps. It is easy for history to be forgotten in a time when the Empire was young, and the many troubles to a primitive race may bury some of their past in time. The true origins of the humans is mostly unknown. Many believe that they were created by their pantheon. Others suggest the ancient race known as the Old Ones being their creators. And some simply believe they have always been on the world. What is normally accepted is those important details closely guarded by the dwarfs, a race whose knowledge of history is normally quite reliable. Many years ago, a rather large host of nomadic human tribes traveled through the World's Edge Mountains, fleeing from a green menace which was growing in the Far East, and other human tribes that naturally migrated or fled other terrors. These humans are nothing like those of today. They were primitive, uneducated, with weapons made of basic stick and stone. Many tribes flooded the Old World, some peaceful, proud farmers, others extremely aggressive, being shaped by the land they were once from. The Dawi had taken notice of all these events, rather interested in the curious humans who flooded the lands near them between the years 1500 and 1000 before Sigmar's ascension to Emperor. The humans, on the other hand, were fearful of the Dawi, preferring to keep their distance, undisturbed as they practiced their Druidic faith. But still the Dawi watched as these young tribes settled, traded, and made war upon each other. Humanity had not changed much over the many years. Still, even to this day, the many tribes that eventually formed into the Imperial provinces still hold on to a similar nature as their ancient ancestors. Slowly, they would progress, building small villages and uniting with other tribes when larger threats arose. Many monstrous beastmen stalked the forests. Greenskinned tribes would come from the east looking for a good fight, and warriors who were dedicated to darker powers. Within time, these early tribes would learn the art of basic forging, moving away from a more nomadic lifestyle in favor of founding large towns and cities. A shadow of what yet was to come. Many famous cities that still stand towards this day were founded back then. Altdorf, Nuln, Middenheim, among others. It was during this time that many tribes had flooded the lands eventually known as the Empire. Many cultures spread throughout the soon-to-be provinces. The weaker tribes who had already settled here had to learn to adapt or leave, lest they be destroyed by their stronger neighbors. As the humans grew into their new homes, so did their people. The various human tribes saw a boon in their respective populations, as their way of life was relatively undisturbed. While it is true that the early Imperials had troubles to deal with, such as the primitive beastmen, followers of the Dark Gods, and savage greenskins, sheer numbers and uneasy alliances would make quick work of the invaders. It is also important to note that many greenskin tribes were rather occupied with the Dawi in the mountain passes, with many of their war bosses finding much more entertainment fighting the technologically advanced and heavily armored dwarves. Such defenses would not last for long, however, for the Dawi reproduce at a much slower rate than humans, and eventually, more and more greenskins would flood into the lands soon to be known as the Old World. Many of the early human tribes found themselves forced into a full-scale war, with an enemy far larger and more ferocious than themselves. Towns were raided and destroyed, its populace enslaved or outright eaten by their invaders. Humanity within those reaches of the Old World would have been lost were it not for the birth of their savior, their god, Sigmar Heldenhammer. When many think of Sigmar, they think of the Imperial God. Many do not normally look back to a time when Sigmar Heldenhammer walked upon the world as not a god, but as a mortal man. Born of the Heldenhammer family, the ruling family of the Umbrogan tribe, who settled far west into the lands of the would-be empire, his birth was hailed by a passing of a twin-tailed comet, a sign of the greatness that was to come. At the time of his birth, the Umbrogan were thrown into a war with the vicious Greenskins and many of the other tribes who dwelt close to the River Rike. He was strong of body and mind, even as from birth, growing up in a cruel and dark world. He wished for the safety of not only his fellow tribesmen, but humanity as a whole. As soon as he could fight, Sigmar stood for his people. By the time that he was only 15 years old, he was leading skirmishes against the Greenskins, who sought to make the Old World their personal playground. As fate would have it, Sigmar and his warriors would happen across an orc warboss, Vagra's Headstomper, another threat to his people. But little did he know, the Greenskins held precious captives. Sigmar and his men launched an offensive against the savages, slaying many of them. Many believe the orcs would have won that day were it not for one of the Greenskins' prisoners throwing a hammer at Sigmar to slay the warboss. That prisoner was none other than Kurgan Ironbeard, the king of Karazakarak, a dwarf of great prestige. Kurgan was eternally grateful for being rescued by the young human, so much so that he gifted Sigmar a magical hammer. The same hammer which would act as a sign of power within the soon-to-be-formed empire, from that day until the end of days. Galmaraz, a weapon that would distinguish many an emperor for many years to come. Sigmar Heldenhammer and Kurgan Ironbeard would form a friendship from this day that would affect both the humans of the Old World and the Darwi. A bond of friendship within both races where they would trade, lend aid in battle, and offer support in their darkest hours. An alliance which has served both well in the years to come. It was shortly after this that Sigmar's father had passed on, and the young warrior took over the Umbrogan tribe as chieftain. Sigmar had taken command with no resistance. He was the son of their leader. He proved to be a fierce warrior, and forged a mighty friendship with the Darwi. Who better to rule than he? To save humanity from a dark fate. Sigmar rose to the position of the Umbrogan with little trouble, leading with great pride and love for his people. But it was not enough that he protect his fellow tribesmen. Sigmar wished to protect humanity as a whole. Only together could the humans of this world stand against the horrors that rise each and every day. When not at war, Sigmar led his men to the various human tribes that dwelt near his Umbrogan, lending aid to any who required it and slowly building up their trust. Soon enough, a mighty confederation of warriors stood behind him, as more and more people raised their weapons in his name. Despite his best efforts, there were still some who did not believe in Sigmar's great plan. The Bretoni, who would later be known as the Bretonians, did not believe in Sigmar's vision, and thus migrated further west, and later founded their own kingdom. It was the Teutogens, who later would be known as the Middenlanders, who offered more resistance. Not willing to bow down to some young man with dreams of an impossible world, they continued their lifestyle, raiding and pillaging. With Sigmar knowing well enough that as long as the Teutogens lived unopposed, the united human world he had been building could easily be destroyed with such insubordination. He would make an example of the Teutogens and their chieftain, Artur, challenging him to single combat in his very throne room for the rest of his people to bear witness. While indeed Artur was a mighty warrior, he was no match for the young Sigmar, whose voice boomed with the very will of the gods. Soon enough, the great chieftain lay dead, and all the tribes who would later form part of the present-day empire stood united under the name Sigmar Heldenhammer. With little time to rest, Sigmar rallied his fellow chieftains to council. He spoke to them about the world and how it was their right to carve a future in it. However, there were still many threats that stood against them. The Greenskins were growing in numbers, far larger than they. And as while he spoke, the Darwi were holding off the largest gathering of Greenskins the world had ever seen. Humanity must stand together in the wake of this massive horde, and end aid to their newfound allies, lest the horde eventually destroy them all. With a rallying cry of to war, Sigmar and a massive host of warriors headed to the famed Blackfyre Pass. There they would aid the Darwi and secure the future that was yet to come. The soon-to-be Imperials had arrived just in time. The Darwi numbers were dwindling as the green tide threatened to envelop them. Here, human and dwarf fought together once again as they charged their ferocious foe from multiple sides. The combined forces did manage to break the green horde, even for just a little while. However, the orcs and goblins were far more scared of their war boss than the great army who stood before them. Urgluck Bloodfang, a fierce greenskin which has not seen equal for many, many years, led this green onslaught. He, like many war bosses of the past, present and future, dreamt of proving themselves to be the biggest and the strongest, and to turn the world into their personal playgrounds. And he would have done so, were it not for Sigmar's sheer determination. In the midst of battle, the would-be emperor sighted the hulking orc, and led his strongest warriors to charge against him. Sigmar battled Urgluck in single combat for over an hour, while his bodyguard of Knights of the White Wolf dealt with any greenskins trying to help their war boss. Ultimately, Bloodfang fell, as the combined forces of humans and dwarves shredded through the now broken lines of orcs and goblins. It is said that it would take over 1,000 years for the greenskins to regain their numbers lost from the Battle of Blackfyre Pass, for any who were captured were slaughtered without prejudice. The battle had been won, the orcs were defeated, and now it was time to return home. It was after the famed Battle of Blackfyre Pass when the humans returned home, where it was decided that humanity is strongest together. Only together could they brave the horrors of the world, and only one man could see humanity prosper, Sigmar Heldenhammer. And so it was so that Sigmar was crowned Emperor of Man, the first of many to bear this title, and certainly the greatest. From that day on, Sigmar and his fellow tribal leaders founded the famed Imperial provinces, some of which still stand to this day. 12 provinces were founded on the first year of the now Imperial calendar, each by one of the Empire's respective leaders and tribes. Hreichland by the Umbarokan, Middenland by the Teutogens, Averland by the Burgundians, Drakwald by the Thuringians, Hochland by the Cherusans, Ostermark by the Ostrogoths, Ostland by the Eudoses, Solland by the Menegoths, Stirland by the Azaborns, Talabekland by the Talutans, Westerland by the Endors, and Wissenland by the Merogans. Each of these tribes, with varying cultures and faiths, they each laid the foundation for what was to be one of the greatest nations the Warhammer world had ever seen. The chieftains bestowed a bond of brotherhood to Sigmar, and with that, their loyalty undying. Sigmar knew well enough that he was but a man, and was not able to govern the Empire by himself. The lands were far too big, and thus his newfound allies were given the title of Count, each tasked to look over the territory their tribes had settled in. To honor the position granted to each Count, the Darwi presented them each with a magical blade, the famed Runefangs, as a sign of friendship and respect. For years the Empire saw peace, many towns and cities were founded, roads paved the way to the many provinces. No harm would befall the Empire. Peace looked to be a constant in the Empire, and now Sigmar, the first Emperor of Man, looked towards a task left unfulfilled. He had ruled for over 50 years, and now the Empire had grown to a massive degree, to the point that its various rulers could govern without him. It was then that he headed east, never to be seen again in mortal form. We'll be discussing Sigmar Heldenhammer's mortal life and ascension to godhood in a future video, but for now, there is much to discuss. With Sigmar now gone, it fell towards the Council of the Empire to lead the now leaderless nation. Sigmar had never married and had never sired an heir. He had ruled for 50 years before he moved on. And interestingly enough, it would seem that the Counts believed he would rule forever, despite being only a mortal man. It was soon enough when peace throughout the court was disrupted, and the many Counts argued about who should rule after Sigmar, with each Count laying claim to rule. Civil war would have been possible, were it not for the fact that the reigning Counts only had the best interest of the Empire in mind. Where a priestess of Rhea made but a simple suggestion of hosting an election between the Counts on who should be the next Emperor. Seeing it as the most diplomatic option and the best way to avoid a war, the Counts retired to the Great Hall in Altdorf, and did not leave for 3 whole days. When they eventually emerged, a new Emperor had been crowned. Emperor Folk of Wissenland would now rule over the Empire as Sigmar did before him. Since then, many emperors have risen to power through this rather diplomatic situation. Yes, some of the Counts did try to buy each other's influence, but in the end, only the one with the most influence would truly rule. It was since then that all emperors had been chosen through this newly created system, with the Counts renaming themselves to the famously known title of Elector Counts. For a number of years after this event, there was peace within the Empire. A peace that would only be disrupted when a man by the name of Johann Hellstrom walked into the now imperial capital of Null. A quick side note here. It is up to the reigning emperor to decide where the imperial capital truly is. And as we have seen many emperors come and go, the main capital has also changed for the most part. Johann walked the streets with what many considered to be the ramblings of a madman, preaching that he had received visions from Sigmar himself, claiming that Sigmar had ascended to godhood, and it was by the right of the people of the Empire that they should worship him above all others as the chief deity of their grand pantheon. Naturally, the worshippers of the other gods originally did not worry about the words of a madman, merely laughing at his claims, and yet still allowing him to build a temple dedicated to Sigmar in Sigmar's hometown of Altdorf. Seeing as Johann had only preached about love and unity throughout the Empire, and was indeed not bringing any harm to the fairly new nation. What they did not expect is that Johann's faith in Sigmar would soon spread throughout the Empire at a rapid pace. The cult of Sigmar, as it was known, had received recognition throughout the reaches of the Empire, with Johann taking the title of Grand Theogonist. With time, the southern imperial provinces had seen a drastic change in faith, where once they followed Ulrich as their chief deity, now they worship Sigmar, the man they once followed. With time, the cult of Sigmar became one of the most powerful religions within the Empire, and as can be expected, they eventually acquired the right to vote on who would be the next emperor. Over the next few centuries, much would change throughout the Empire. The cult of Sigmar would grow more and more, but it was not just religion that would develop this nation, but also expansion and destruction. New tribes were brought into the Empire, where those who would then become the citizens of Sylvania were absorbed into the growing nation. Many of the provinces expanded their borders to massive degrees, but yet there were some who were not so lucky, where provinces such as Drakwald were destroyed after foolishly trying to root out the Wood Elves who dwelt within the region, starting their fall into history. We'll be going over the provinces of the Empire, including the Mootland, in their own future videos. Since the creation of the Empire, over the thousands of years that it has stood strong, there have been many emperors. Some have ruled with great intentions, seeing Sigmar's creation as a place of unity for humanity, where those who would serve would be treated with compassion. But unfortunately, as is common with the greed of men, some rose to power who only acted in their own interests, preferring status above the will of the people. It was during this horrible time where all imperial nobility saw their vanity take over, where in truth, for a while, the Empire stopped expanding both in power and culturally. Art and religion had boomed within these days, but indeed, many see this time as an era of laziness and greed. The recent line of emperors had seen much change to the lands of the empire. A line of Drakwalders ruled, and their greed and jealousy would forever weaken the empire in many wars to come. To this day, people still look back to a time where rulers such as Ludwig the Fat and Boris the Incompetent saw their great nation weakened, and in truth, almost destroyed. What little remnants of the Drakwalders are left are normally treated with suspicion. It was during the reign of Boris the Incompetent, whose love for gold was far stronger than that of his people, where the end almost came. Plague swept across the land. Whole regions were left barren and empty, as all throughout the empire, suffering had been taking over the land. Its people cried out, was this the end of days? Trade with other nations would halt. Prayers would be left unanswered. The infected would be put to death. Where was their emperor? Hiding away in his palace, of course, only allowing the richest of subjects safety within its untainted walls. Little did the people of the empire know, or anyone else for that matter, was that the plague was not just some random natural occurrence, but rather the creation of clan pestilence. One of the leading Skaven clans, who at this point worked together with the other clans to begin what would be known as the Skaven Wars. As the plagues ran rampant across the lands of the Empire, so too did the vicious Ratmen. Entire cities had been wiped clean of all life. Many of the nobility, including the failed Emperor, had succumbed to the plague. And now the Skaven armies flooded the surface world, with little hope of stopping them. The remaining Imperials braced themselves for what could have been their end. One by one, cities fell, and yet they still fought on. Despite their best efforts, they would have surely fallen were it not for one man. Mandred von Zelt, later known as Mandred Skavenslayer, who heroically broke the siege of Middenheim and rallied the remaining forces of the Empire, defeating the Skaven, despite the incredible odds stacked against them. So damaging was this invasion that only 3/10 of the population of this great nation yet lived. And while they did indeed live, it was up to them to rebuild and grow once again. Naturally, those who had seen Mandred Skavenslayer command with such ferocity, even at the brink of extinction of his people, knew that there was no one better to lead them like he was. Most of the empire was in ruins, and only a man like he could see it prosper once again. For 25 years he ruled. Much had been rebuilt, but so much knowledge was lost. The empire had seen an age of prosperity, which unfortunately was not to last. While the Imperials began to rebuild and grow, they sadly began to forget of the Skaven invasion, forgetting they even existed in the first place. The Skaven, however, never forget such losses, simply waiting for the perfect moment to strike. Hidden away in the cover of night, Mandred Skavenslayer, the hero they so desperately needed, was slaughtered, and once again, the Empire was left without an Emperor. For years, the Empire would see a time of strife once again, where many claimed the throne of Emperor above all others. It was not enough that many declared themselves ruler, where a small civil war had broken out, not just politically and in a militaristic sense, but religiously too, where each leader declared themselves and their province they ruled over as wholly devout to their chosen deity. Provinces devoted to the cult of Sigmar would see themselves clashing against those devoted to the cult of Ulric. Thankfully, while many were at odds against each other, it was not uncommon for the greater empire to unite when needed, banding together despite their current differences to fight against a larger threat, where the two self-chosen emperors put aside their differences as the call to war had been sounded during the event that would later be known as the Great Crusades. Despite their differences, they could not allow the people of Araby to sack and enslave the nations of Estalia and Talia. For a time, the empire was united as they and the many knightly orders lent aid to Bretonnia in their Grand Crusade. For at least 200 years, there was peace. But once the dust would settle, the political differences would appear once again. At this time, two held the self-proclaimed title of emperor, but soon enough, they would be free. And soon enough, another civil war would break out. The emperors and their armies would be embodied in a bloody civil war, and were all too occupied to pay attention to the happenings in other provinces, until it was too late. Dark happenings had begun to stir through the lands of Sylvania, eventually seeing their independence of the county of Stirland, and their own province being formed. But that was the least of their troubles. A massive greenskin invasion had ravaged and destroyed the imperial province of Solland, and in truth, almost destroyed the empire as a whole, were it not for once again the persistence of men and their unwillingness to die out. The empire's future lay on a thin thread, where provincial rulers would not trust one another, and the vision that Sigmar had so long ago looked to be fully fading. Still, they persisted as best as humans can, and again, they worked on rebuilding. Yet while they were occupied with the Greenskins, the people of the Empire did not pay attention to what was happening in Sylvania. Strange rumors of the dead walking again, of ageless beings as strong as 100 men, and magics that could make the bravest of warriors cower in terror. An ancient vampire by the name of Vlad von Karstein had worked his way into the lands of Sylvania, marrying the daughter of the Count of Sylvania, slowly biding his time as the loving couple slowly prepared an unholy war to wage against the Empire. In truth, the vampiric couple helped Sylvania flourish for the first time in years. Yes, despite the fact that Vlad and Isabella were vampires, they truly felt that they deserved to rule over the Empire as a whole. A dark kingdom where the living and the dead would serve or else. For 200 years they bode their time, ruling Sylvania and amassing a grand army. When the time was right, they would strike hard and fast. The undead swept through the lands of the Empire on numerous occasions. First by Vlad and Isabella, whose forces almost broke the Empire at the Siege of Altdorf. The undead flooded the Empire, cities fell, and many, many people killed and razed. The undead would have surely taken the Empire, and perhaps even more so, were it not for the heroic sacrifice of the Grand Theogenist at the time, Wilhelm III, who grabbed onto Vlad von Karstein, throwing them both off the battlements of the city, killing them both. The main bulk of the von Karstein forces quickly crumbled into dust as their sire perished. But this was not the end of the undead in the Empire. Many of Vlad's vampiric children fled the battlefield back to Sylvania, and would have been destroyed for good were it not once again for the petty political differences of the various elector counts still vying for themselves to become emperor, rather than destroy an already weakened foe. This gave time for the vampires to regain their strength, where they returned from the borders of Sylvania not once but twice more. Firstly, under the command of the ravenous Conrad von Karstein, whose pure bloodlust tore through the Empire like his sire before him. So deadly was this vampire that many elector counts, despite their differences, were forced to unite once again to destroy this lifeless threat. While the Empire would achieve victory over the vampires of Sylvania once again, another would take up the mantle of Count. Manfred von Karstein took control of his vampiric brethren as quickly as the time was right. Unsurprisingly, the Empire was caught in yet another civil war when Manfred took over his bloodline's role as head of the family, easily marching towards Altdorf with little resistance. Yet thankfully, Manfred would find himself defeated on a number of occasions, due to losing much of his forces after Kurt III, the Grand Theogenist at the time, recited the Great Spell of Unbinding. After a series of defeats, the vampiric forces were forced to retreat back to their homeland, where a combined imperial force marched through and destroyed many of the unliving monsters as they could. As far as the humans had been aware, Manfred was struck down, and the evil that covered Sylvania eventually would lift. The county of Stirland would annex Sylvania, however, for the most part, it would be left undisturbed, with the Stirlanders wanting no part in its rebuilding. Little did the Imperials know, such evils would never truly be banished from the now seemingly lifeless controlled lands. For a time there would be peace. It was a simple time in a dark world. For 100 years the Empire would continue to grow, but even so, one cannot expect peace for long. For far in the north, a terrifying army was preparing itself to launch an invasion in the name of the Dark Gods of Chaos. Corrupted warriors, ferocious beastmen, and warping demons who would wish to shake the very foundations of the world. an event known as the Great War Against Chaos, which would see many of the races of the Warhammer world unite in an effort to save all that was dear to them. We'll be covering the Great War Against Chaos in a later video, as I rather go into detail and dedicate a whole series to this event. What can be said about this Great War is that some good came from it. Despite the many losses humanity had taken, their newfound friendship with the elves saw the Imperials learning on how to harness the winds of magic, seeing the creation of the Imperial Colleges of Magic, and under Magnus the Pious, the Empire would once again be allowed to grow and prosper. Despite many setbacks, none can disagree that Sigmar's vision still held strong. And since the reign of Magnus, many powerful emperors have seen to the strengthening of this strong-minded nation. In 2,500 years, we have seen the birth of a nation, the rise of not only a man who unified countless tribes, but also the rise of a mighty god. Many wars have been fought, many men have died, but the will of men cannot be denied. In due course, we will look towards the reign of the current emperor, Karl Franz. And with that, my friends, we've come to the end of our lore video. Thank you so much for watching. If you did enjoy the video, might I suggest giving the video a like, or even subscribing to the channel, as it really does help us out. Once again, thank you so much for watching, and I shall see you all again very, very soon. Have a good day.